This is the mobile panel. I'm going to introduce our speakers. We're going to try to catch up a little bit on time here. First, immediately on my left is Michael Barrett, the CEO of Millennial Media. Then Ernie Cormier, the CEO of NextAge, and Michael Rubenstein, the president of AppNexus. I'm going to ask each of them to briefly introduce themselves and their companies and to be honest with us about how their bracket is doing. You're first.
So if I were being judged on my bracket, I wouldn't be up on this panel right now. I've lost everyone. I'm Michael Barrett. I'm CEO of Millennial Media. Millennial is a company that was founded in 06. I have the great pleasure of just joining recently, less than 2 months ago, as CEO. We, as the name would imply, do media. So we have a terrific sales team that's out there calling on agencies and marketers direct in selling mobile inventory. We also have a DSP product where we can work with marketers that want to buy programmatically. In partnership with our friends from AppNexus, we run one of the largest mobile exchanges, MMX. We also have a DMP that powers that exchange and powers some of our other media products. So we kind of play in a lot of different pieces of the ecosystem, and it gives us a unique perspective, and delighted to be here today.
Ernie.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Ernie Cormier, CEO of NextAge. As far as my bracket, I think most people are busted at this point, but I'm going to go out on a limb and pick the UConn woman to win it all. So proud to say CEO, leader of a great team at NextAge for about 4 years. We are a mobile pure play. We're actually one of the leaders in programmatic. We were the original lead authors of the OpenRTB mobile spec way back in the fourth quarter of 10, and then released it first quarter of 11. So for us at NextAge, seeing a show like this, a conference like this, is particularly gratifying, that because we've been out there for years kind of pounding the drums of programmatic, frankly, when there was a lot of skepticism out in the market. So for us, the growth over the past year or two has been extremely gratifying. So it's mobile pure play, apps and web, work with premium publishers and premium buyers all around the world, very much focused on the premium side, both on the supply, working with large multi-screen, large app publishers, as well as brand spend on the buy side. I'm very happy to be here, and thanks for the opportunity.
Yeah. Michael.
Great. I'm Michael Rubenstein, president of AppNexus. AppNexus is a New York City-based technology company that builds programmatic tools that allow buyers and sellers of media to trade media programmatically, and we power marketplaces between them as well. This week is an exciting one for me because we started in desktop display. And a year ago, during this week, we announced to the industry that we were going all in on mobile, which meant that we were launching a huge dedicated team and massive development effort toward taking our desktop display-oriented business and orienting it toward mobile. And we saw the trends in the marketplace, saw the trends in our customer base, and realized that this was something that we needed to do to capitalize on an incredible shift happening in the market, an incredible opportunity. And over the last year, we have invested all of our heft and capabilities toward bringing our programmatic capabilities toward the mobile space. And you know, I'm proud to say at this conference that you know, we now have about 60,000 active campaigns running in mobile across 10 billion impressions a day, fantastic global partnerships, including our landmark partnership with Millennial Media, which is a significant accelerant to the world of programmatic inside mobile. And so I'm thrilled to be here on this panel today. If only my bracket were looking so good. I'm not sure why Creighton seemed like a good idea at the
time. All right, let me just start off with the first basic question of whether we should even have this panel. Is there something distinct or unique about mobile programmatic as opposed to other online desktop programmatic? Michael?
I was CEO of AdMeld, and so we were one of the early players in the SSP, so we got to see programmatic from kind of a bird's eye view there. And yeah, there are definitely differences, but in the end, is there enough differences where it's such a different flavor of programmatic that it's programmatic with a small p or whatever the case? And the answer is absolutely not. You have the same buyers, and in large part the same sellers, There's different vernacular, there's different technology. Some things you can port over from display, some things you can't. But the fact of the matter is we should be talking about it all in one bucket, because ultimately the goal isn't to be up here on a mobile conference or a mobile panel or a video panel or a display panel. It's to be up here and saying, hey, I'm chasing audiences programmatically. I'm agnostic to what media device and or what channel it shows up in. I just want the results I'm looking for. So if I'm a branded advertiser, I want those results. If I'm a performance, I want those results. But you're kind of, you really don't care if it all showed up on mobile, video, or desktop.
Ernie? I agree with Michael to a certain extent, but if for no other reason than to have a little fun and tension on the panel, I have to disagree. I have to disagree with some pieces of that. So within mobile, you've got a unique environment where you basically have a cookie-less environment. So you have these kind of negative challenges, if you will, the disparity of the device types and all that, which is still not going away and really won't go away at all. And if you come out of the handset or carrier world, you know that that's not going to go away. And then on the positive side, you've got the opportunities for engagement that mobile provides that desktop just doesn't and won't, whether that's around location or kind of usability, personality of the device and those kinds of things. So while I agree that on the media planning side, there will mobile and mobile programmatic, the forces behind mobile programmatic are the same around efficiency, and you saw some of the drivers that Joanna cited earlier. Those are all the same. I agree with that completely. But there are pieces of programmatic that will specifically and have already benefited mobile that really make it different. So whereas in the online world, you have, at least up until a year or so ago, programmatic was seen as a drive to the bottom and basically lower prices. In mobile, it's exactly the opposite. And in mobile, we see higher CPMs on programmatic than we see elsewhere. We see the opportunity for premium publishers to kind of preserve their brand, maintain ad quality, get the efficiencies programmatic drives, and yet still deliver the capabilities that mobile has that are unique to mobile, again, both negative and positive. So I guess my answer is a little bit of a mixed side, and it depends on where you're looking in the ecosystem.
And Ernie, why are the CPMs higher on mobile?
Because we believe that within mobile, really the only way to buy audience targeting, as Michael pointed out, is programmatically. Today, that manifests through RTB. As Direct comes online, and Programmatic Direct, we think, will grow enormously this year. There'll be other ways to do it. But within RTB, the only way that a buyer who's looking to buy audience at scale on mobile can see enough inventory and make those decisions on an impression-by-impression basis is programmatically. There's no way to do that through any kind of direct block buys or any kind of ad network block buys. And so that's why we think, you know, that's the case.
Okay. Michael, anything unique about, distinct about mobile programs?
Well, I think it's the curse of any new mass ad medium that it's sort of generally viewed through the lens of the model that we already know. And so there's a lot of sort of traditional display thinking applied today to the mobile environment. But you're starting to see that change. I mean, one of the unique things that programmatic allows, obviously, is the layering on of unique first-party and third-party data assets or other targeting capabilities. So in mobile, for example, even at this early stage, what we're seeing is 80% of campaigns feature some location targeting capability, which is obviously different than what you would see in traditional display, and I think starts to speak to brands and advertisers really starting to capitalize on some of the unique capabilities that mobile offers.
Okay. Let's talk about the overall migration within mobile towards programmatic. Joanne had some slides earlier that I think the numbers were 96% of desktop was managed programmatically, or that was a channel. I think this was volume, not dollars. 64% was the case with mobile. Michael, let me start with you. Do you think that that's just a matter of catch-up time before mobile is programmatically shifted as online or desktop?
Yeah, I think so. You know, you could read the estimates. I mean, I think Magna Global came out with a survey recently that said north of 80% of ads would be transacted programmatically in mobile by 2017. And that's obviously significantly higher than what it looks like today. But if you look at the growth trend, it's so strong today that it's not hard to see it moving in that direction. And as Neil mentioned, you know, in the session before this, what we're seeing in desktop today and traditional display is even brand advertising starting to really get impacted by programmatic. And I thought what the slide Joanna showed also, that showed connected TV starting to change as well, is interesting. And so I do think that as a environment that sort of is growing to maturity at the same time as programmatic, I think you're already seeing stronger adoption of programmatic in mobile, and I do think it's only a matter of time until the vast majority, if not you know, basically all ads across all digital channels are bought and sold programmatically. Programmatically meaning in line with the definition Joanna introduced at the beginning of the day, not necessarily RTB.
Mm-hmm. Ernie, you want to comment more on that? And how far do you think that programmatic dollars will shift to programmatic channels?
Sure. So yeah, I do think mobile is moving faster in terms of penetration of programmatic than online. Part of that is because on the buy side, most of those buyers have kind of seen that movie already, right? They've already learned the lessons of what programmatic can deliver, so you get those benefits. Part of it relates to the pieces I was alluding to earlier, and that programmatic, and now speaking specifically of RTB, direct being a little bit of a different flavor of this, programmatic RTB is in mobile really the enabler for audience at scale. That doesn't that has a multiple kind of driver in terms of kind of power behind it than online. So you've got all the efficiencies that everyone's already learned about programmatic, but then you've got mobile with the lack of a cookie and all that, and you know, how do you see audience at scale? RTB being the best way to get there. In terms of a marker for that, I mean, we talked about brand spend. Joanna had some data on brand spend, as did Neil. I mean, for us, speaking for NextAge, in from Black Friday till the end of the year, so let's call it December of 2013, 70% of the programmatic spend in our exchange, in our platform, was driven by brands. And just to give you a sense of how much of that, of our overall volume is about 60%, and this is volume, not revenue, overall about 60% of our volume is programmatic as opposed to through non-programmatic channels. So large majority of our spend in our platform is programmatic, and at least in December, and it's consistent with other parts of the year and consistent with what we've seen since, 70% of that spend was from brands. So you know, we're seeing it happen and move pretty quickly.
Michael, anything about that? Adoption curve?
Yeah, no, I agree with that. I think that, you know, again, from the perspective of AdMel to now Millennial and MMX, the difference in the early days of display, it was a new concept. It required buyers and sellers to kind of get aligned. It was not terribly easy having ad networks, who were one of the biggest buyers of display media, play along with the idea of not being able to have a direct relationship with the publisher. And then you had to light up one by one by one the buyers that were RTB capable. Fast forward to mobile, you know, I think we have over 200 buyers lined up that are RTB capable on MMX. And so, and the number continues to grow. So it's not for lack of the efficacy of programmatic working. Now you just need the dollars to course through the system. And we're relatively early days in mobile, and that's just not a programmatic statement, that's just a broader statement on mobile. And so I think that there's no reason to believe that if programmatic is a driving force across all media, that mobile would be any different. You know, I do think that the big question is the definition of programmatic, and you know, I think Joanne's definition is solid, so we'll do that. But also, I believe that then you want to ask the question: percentage of revenue generated for, say, a publisher from programmatic versus direct sold. Or indirectly sold. And I think that's where you still wind up in a world where most of the inventory is programmatic, perhaps it's not most of the revenue for the publisher.
Let's talk about one of the challenges within mobile, and that's measurement and targeting. And Ernie, you mentioned you know, it's a cookieless environment. How far along do you think we are to the kind of measurement and targeting that's optimal for mobile? Is it it's a problem, but it's workable because there's just enough demand flow there, or is it a gating factor? Like, where is the industry in terms of figuring out mobile measurement and mobile targeting? Ernie, do you want to start?
Sure. So, yeah, I mean, anyone who is telling you it's been fixed and solved, you know, I think maybe you want to put your hand over your wallet or something like that. But the it's we all, just as we have work to do, and Neil mentioned this, and I agree completely, we have work to do on the creative side. Within mobile, we have a lot of work to do on the creative side and catching creative up. But online, back in the mid to late 90s, was the same way. I go back and look at some of the stuff I did in online then, and I cringe and hope no one else has saved it. And so we're in a similar situation with mobile. Around measurement, I don't believe there are any laws of physics problems. I think it's solvable to your framing of it. I don't think we're there yet. We still have work to do, and part of it is delivering the right measurements for the right buyers. You know, different segments of buyers have different measurements that are relevant to them, and part of it is legacy. Part of it is what they're looking to do within their campaigns. So I think we have a lot of work to do, but I think it's all doable, and I think we'll get there.
Okay. Any comments on mobile measurement and targeting?
Yeah, so on the targeting, I mean, I think that you brought it up before, Ernie, the cool thing is there's some unique native aspects of targeting on mobile that are alive today that make it a superior device to other forms of media, location being one, voice being another. There's a lot of things about mobile that you can't overlook that. So not everything's going to be closely correlated or paradigm from the display world. It is really powerful when you can bring in all that data and learning from the display world and bring it into the mobile environment and target with those parameters as well. And that is early stage, but you know, we've talked about cross-screen. That's a big element of that, not just to be able to target two different devices and know it's the same person, but being able to take that wealth of information that you have over here and start to port it over here. That's where special things can occur when you overlay it with the native targeting capabilities. And from a measurement standpoint, mobile does suffer, as does online display, as does most media from attribution. We've been able to, we started a program this Q4 with several brand advertisers to measure offline activity. And so you're starting to be able to create these case studies for your marketers that are very similar to the case studies they see, whether they're advertising on TV or online display. And so there's not a lack of capability or willingness, there's just some unique technical challenges that we're starting to get up to and work around.
Michael, any comments just on targeting and measurement?
Well, I think they've captured it well, but the one thing I would say is there isn't a targeting and measurement challenge in mobile. There's dozens. And in order to solve the problem, quote unquote, there are so many different use cases that need to be addressed. A consumer views an ad in an app and takes action on the mobile web, or views an ad or clicks on an ad in the mobile web and ultimately takes an action later in store or something like that. I mean, there are huge attribution, targeting, tracking problems, and there's an enormous amount of innovation right now going into techniques to address these. Everyone on this stage, as well as many people in this audience. At AppNexus, we've taken an open platform approach. We're developing our own proprietary solutions at the same time as opening our platform and integrating with everybody else's. And so this is likely to be, I think, an area of huge problem-solving investment for many years to come in this space.
Michael, you mentioned something, that cross-device targeting recognition. Where do you think we are? Where is the industry now in terms of having the ability to do that?
Well, I think where we are now, there's a couple of flavors of it, right? There's the one flavor where if you're a large publisher and you have the vast majority of your audience logging in, so they're in a logged in state, that's as pretty good as it gets, right? So you're either logged in on the mobile world, you're logged in on desktop. That's pretty simple to do cross-screen in that respect. Whether it's being done correctly, you see a lot of it being done kind of post-buy, where the advertiser didn't request it, raise their hand for it, but you're able to educate them on the buy and say, hey, look what happened when ad ran here, different types of actions occurred. Both are great. Maybe next time around we should think more about syncing it or being more thoughtful about the messaging and the sequencing of messaging. So to that higher evolved degree, I don't think that that's kind of the standard use case right now. And then you have a bunch of terrific companies that are doing more of a more of algorithms to try to ascertain that person does own that device, that person owns that device. We have a degree of certainty that it's the same person. Let's try to reach them that way. And you have our approach, which is much more of a deterministic approach, where for years and years we've been storing, you know, device IDs. We've been working with large publishers, carriers, to match those device IDs to hashed email addresses, and so then you're able to do that complete bridge where you know it is the person, and we're seeing a big uplift in that business for us. So it is real. It's getting more real. You know, you talk to the big spenders in online today. Large DSP guys, and they're looking for simple solutions. I mean, we're going to be talking in greater detail about, with our partnership with AppNexus, we're going to make it much easier to do cross-screen via the MMX, our exchange. And so we think that this is one of the real exciting areas that we're going to be able to, again, make unique to mobile. And mobile will be the tentpole of it, right?
Ernie, cross-device, cross-screen?
Sure. So cross-screen has been a little bit of the, holy grail for a long time. And as Michael pointed out, there are the big guys, or even the small guys, who have multi-screen login. So it's fairly straightforward for them to link up a device ID with an email address, or at least a cookie online, and then that's kind of opens the doors to everything. And we see that becoming very, very powerful in the market. Then you've got the probabilistic guys who, as Michael pointed out, using algorithms, and whether it's matching your home IP address across your device, across your handheld versus your phone, your computer, and all that, and then linking you between those two. Those are highly probabilistic, and accuracy somewhere around 60-70%. But all of those, and this actually relates as well to attribution as well. I think we have to look at all of those and kind of inject a certain amount of common sense. There's some things that are going to sound, Michael gave the example of you're looking at a few ads and then you make a purchase. What is the attribution of that purchase to which one of those ads? Is it what you saw on the web on your computer this morning, or what you saw on your handheld today, or what you saw on your tablet this afternoon? And anyone who says that the attribution of that is going to be like to the last ad or anything, I think is violating a little bit of common sense. We're going to have to evolve our thinking around which ads or which set of ads or what sequence of campaigns drove the user to through the funnel and to a close. And it's not going to be as simple as what was the last ad seen, which is what I'm seeing a lot of folks taking credit for that today, which I think is a little premature.
Michael, do you have any comments on cross-device, cross-screen?
I think these guys covered it.
All right, let me switch gears and let me ask two broad questions, and then I'll leave a little time for audience questions. First one is, outside of your own companies, which companies do you think stand to benefit the most from real rapid industry adoption of mobile programmatic? Who are some of the cutting edge companies, most innovative companies in the space outside of your own? Michael?
No one. No. I've thought a lot about it. Is no one. Well, so, you know, I think programmatic, a mobile or a video or a display, there's some real efficiency gainers on all sides. So as programmatic increases, everyone benefits in that respect. Who would be the outsized beneficiaries? I think that I think it's two answers. Number one, I think the rich get richer. I think if you're Google, Facebook, Twitter, in some respects Pandora, is creeping into that group, I think that they are able to run proprietary, kind of a soup to nuts, their own exchange, their own direct and programmatic will be the fuel for that. They'll have great targeting information, and I think that that's they'll win, but I do believe there's this rising tide, and they're not going to be able to do all things for everyone. So I think they'll be very, very careful about what can leave their world and go into power other media buys. And so I think there's always going to be a room for someone like a millennial or someone that looks like us, that can do it across, that it doesn't own inventory, that is there running a true platform media company, and can help marketers not just buy in kind of cul-de-sacs, but across all forms of exchanges and all forms of media. So, I do think that there are programmatic's going to make it easier for dollars to come into the marketplace. And really, honestly, it's not programmatic versus direct sold versus anything in mobile right now. It's really getting more dollars into the marketplace to chase the supply that's there. And programmatic will help that.
Ernie?
This is what Michael's sitting here. It's going to sound like I'm sucking up, which I'm not trying to do. But I've always looked at AppNexus as a very strong, I really think the tech that they've built is very strong with, I guess, as a former engineer, I tend to value that pretty highly. So I think AppNexus is very well positioned. I think their strategy for essentially being a tools provider is very powerful and has certainly proven itself over the decades in various phases of tech. Kind of stepping back from companies, though, and looking at some sectors that may go kind of under the radar, there are a couple that I think are going to benefit dramatically from programmatic. One is large entities, mostly publishers, who are going to be looking to do customer acquisition basically directly. And cutting out a layer of inefficiency and margin and all that. And also, to the point about using about targeting earlier, being able to leverage their own internal data sets that they do not want to let outside the firewall. The second group that I would say is kind of going under the radar, and this is more outside of Western Europe and the States, is that we're seeing a lot of demand that's surfacing within more of the developing markets that want to buy programmatically. In fact, for some of the inventory we have, the only way they can get that inventory is to buy programmatically. And so they're climbing the learning curve, going from essentially media agencies all the way up to programmatic buyers very, very quickly. And we think that in the next year or two, that group, kind of as a group or a sector, will have a big swing on the market. Because at least in the app world, not really the mobile web world, but the app world, it's instantaneous worldwide distribution. Rovio drops a title onto the app store or the marketplace, and pretty much overnight they've got worldwide distribution. And for a lot of those game pubs that we work with anyway, their largest markets are outside of the Western world. And so when you start seeing the evolution that can happen on the media buying side there, augmented with tools from companies like us and frankly AppNexus and others, I think the acceleration there is going to be extreme.
Michael? Would you want to say next age?
You know,
absolutely. Next age of millennial, hands down. Thanks, Ernie.
You're welcome.
I think, look, you've got a market that today is nascent and over the next several years should grow to tens of billions of dollars in spend. And that's exciting. And I think for anyone, big or small, there's a great opportunity in there, especially, you know, we've talked about the benefits enumerated to programmatic buying and selling, opening up new ways of targeting audiences, opening up new ways of reaching advertisers and brands worldwide. And so I think, you know, whether it's a full-scale, you know, display company moving into programmatic, and we're certainly seeing a lot of that today. Companies like Google and Rocket Fuel, sponsors of this conference, are aggressively moving into the mobile programmatic space, or native mobile companies like NextSage and Millennial embracing the programmatic opportunity and leveraging their position and expertise in the market. You know, there should be tremendous opportunity, I think, for everyone. And even on the publisher side, Joanna mentioned in her opening that, you know, publishers have been nonplussed about CPMs, and of course that's been part of the storyline over the last several years, but the gap is closing. In display, CPMs are up 25 to 60% over the last 18 months, and you're starting to see in mobile the gap between direct sold and programmatic not being as big as one might have thought, especially as programmatic grows to include a lot more of what was traditionally direct sold. I think that folks who are in any part of the ecosystem who are embracing mobile and embracing programmatic stand to gain a lot. I think it's more a question of, if you're not doing it, you're in trouble. And I think that it's sort of like if you were in a room full of print publishers or advertisers who are only running in traditional media, and it was the late 90s, and they were considering not embracing the online channel. I mean, that's sort of the state you're sitting in today. There's a huge burgeoning market with massive, massive, massive risks for not adopting. I think that's where we are at this moment.
Let me close out with one last question. This is kind of the case study question or case studies question. Would each of you want to talk about a publisher or a couple of publishers or ad buyers that you think really have been ahead of the curve, have really gotten it, have fully embraced programmatic, whether it's across the board or just mobile, and have had a lot of success in doing that? Can you bring it down to a case study or two for us? Ernie, do you want to start?
Sure. So one thing that hasn't come up here is something that was hot a couple years ago and then kind of disappeared, but it's actually become a huge part of our business, and that's so-called private exchanges. And so we have a whole host of over 25%, and it'll be approaching 50% this year, of our publishers will be heavily utilizing private exchange of one form or another. And we have several publishers, Rovio being one, there are several others, that have moved totally to private exchange. So they have a direct sale, in the case of Rovio, they have a direct sales force, and this is all public knowledge, so I hope I'm not divulging anything. I'll find out later on today. They have a very large and growing direct sales force, very effective, and everything else that they have, all their other inventory, is only available through a private exchange on our platform. That's worldwide. So that was a huge move for them last year. It's been, I know I'll get in trouble if I divulge the results, but the results have been very, very positive for them in terms of revenue, in terms of user experience, driven by ads per session and things like that. And ad quality, which is something that was touched on earlier this morning, but is a huge driver, certainly for brand spend, ad quality and brand safety has gone up dramatically for them. So, and we have many other publisher examples similar to that.
Okay, that's great. Michael, do you want a case study you want to talk about?
Well, not to tee up too much of a softball, but I think your next speaker, Netflix, has done a pretty great job of driving subscriptions and driving awareness of its fantastic offering through the programmatic and multi-channel offerings. And so I'm sure you'll be hearing a lot more about that shortly.
Okay. Michael, last word.
Yeah, well, so early days for me at the company, so I definitely don't know what I can and can't say. Further complicated
Perfect.
By the fact that
Especially
we're public. But we recently completed on MMX a brand campaign that was originally for a CPG company that was originally targeted to go through our normal media channel, but they said, hey, would it be possible to run it programmatically? And so it kind of came across first as an IO that then got kicked to more of a programmatic buy. And from what I understand, it not only exceeded expectations in terms of performance, there was more money than originally that was allocated towards it. So there's my case study that doesn't have any stats or... Faxer, the name of this company.
Case study on the fly.
Which is kind of like an ad exchange or case study, so it's perfect. Oh, man, whoa.
All right, I think we're just about out of time. Does anybody want...
Way to make friends.
Would anybody like to ask a question or make a comment from the audience? And if not, we'll bring this session to a close. We're about out of time anyway, but just one, if you can jump on the mic or yell it out, whatever you like.
Hey, I'm Tom from Live Intent, and we do real-time exchange and email and newsletters. And you were mentioning a lot of the challenges you have for mobile is that you can't, it's a cookie-less environment. And we've been successful to retarget to the email hash, which you mentioned. I was wondering if you knew of any other data sources that are out there that can overcome the challenges of cookies.
Ernie, do you want to?
Not so much single data sources, more of a collection of data sources. For us, we have a program called NextAge Connect, and I only bring it up as an example of what an AppNexus has, the App Store, and very similar, whereby you can bring a collection of, the data store, I'm sure I got the name wrong, where you can, as a buyer or a seller, you can basically have access to a number of third-party data providers, and the way our platform works, you literally can kind of switch them on and off, and we manage all the settlement the data flow through the platform and all that. So it's not so much a kind of a killer data set. There are killer data sets out there, but they're proprietary, held within firewalls. In terms of available to everyone, it's more being smart and working with someone and like us or some of our competitors, at least just a couple of them, who have that kind of multiple data offerings that you can leverage.
Great. Anybody else? If not, I'm going to bring this session to a close, and I want to thank our three speakers, Michael Rubenstein, AppNexus, Ernie Cormier from NextAge, and Michael Barrett with Millennial Media. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Mark.